So let's dance. My name is Recky. I'm from Hanau PM in Germany, and I work as self-employed program and system administrator. My presentation today, I will talk about Dancer, the micro framework which we are working on with Sawyer, and DBX Glass, the OEM, which many people use and call. And I will describe how to use both in conjunction. I started with Dancer 3 years ago after I listened to a really awesome presentation from Sawyer and from Austin. And just after that, I really started with it. Sometimes you learn something on conference and yeah, you forget it and you don't have a use case for it. But I started like a month later with a project for a customer. And I and he, we were really glad about it. And yeah, there are a couple of things I want to say about Dancer, which made it my favorite web framework. The first thing is it's really easy to start with. You can get an application ready to go with just one command. The syntax is easy to understand. And the most important things you need at first are roots and keywords, which means the roots are for deciding what to do on a request from the browser or from the user. And keywords really help you to have a function which are easy to use. And the proof of that is that we are on the IRC channel of Dancer, often see people coming in which don't have prior knowledge or don't have prior knowledge about web frameworks. And they're really able to do stuff in Dancer without much help. So that's one point why I use Dancer. Next one, it's really easy to expand. There are a lot of plugins. The Dancer core is really small, but if you have other features like sending emails, access to database, flash message, there are a lot of things where you find plugins on CBAN, on GitHub, and it's also relatively easy to write. So for small expansion like changing the layout of the template looks like in general, collecting information and so on, there are hooks which are really small functions which blend into your workflow. And our thing is why Dancer is so flexible. You have engines for a lot of things. With the engines, you can exchange them. You have engines for the templates, of course. You have a lot of engines for template systems on call. And you know there are a lot of them. There's, of course, one for template toolkit, for Xlate, and for a lot of others. You have engines for logging, for the sessions, and also for serializer. So. And finally, it's solid. It's stable. It runs really good. You don't have to get power supply unless you do really bad programming and stuff like that. We try to keep the behavior. We don't change the DSL, the keywords unpredictably or changing stuff which really affect your application. And there's a great community around Dancer. I already mentioned the IRC channel where you can get help. We have a mailing list and we on GitHub. There's a lot of communication with users opening issues or sending them pull requests. So if you start Dancer, you get help. And people are all over the place. Okay, so that's the Dancer part. My first application I wrote was a simple Dropbox client for the company in New York. I didn't do much, but it was very helpful for them because they used the commercial Dropbox and they want to have an easy way to exchange files with the customers or between the different branches of the company. And they also wanted to have their files open. A part of this project is on CBAN. which has some common functions if you want to implement it in Dropbox like that. Recently we started to move this code over to DBX class, which makes sense because we're using it for our projects too. I did a lot of websites for the US government. The most prominent is the eShop state.gov, where we're doing procurement for a lot of places, which get books, which get presentation things all over the world. And recently I bought a simple monitor for a power plant, really big power plant in Oregon. They have a lot of, wind wheels. And you go into their Microsoft SQL database and source all the information about wind speed, how much power they make, all that, and puts up nicely on one website, and we're doing a nice graph with chart clicker, and it was really helpful for them. So the other part I'm talking about is the DBX class. There, of course, our object relationship managers in Power, but I think this is the most popular one and many people using it. Basically, let you use, instead of directly going to the SQL database and drawing doing statements and getting hash refs out of it or error refs, it allows you to get objects out of it. And you don't need to worry so much about the performance, because the programmers behind DBX class, especially River Sushi, they did a lot of optimizations. So in most cases, it will really be really fast and better than yourself writing something. But if you want to, you can still do that. If you have really special queries, which is hard to map to an object, you can do that with DBX class too. So one of our major projects is to write an open source e-commerce application called Interchange, which has a really old code base and is stable, and you can do a lot of things with it, but it's hard to understand and to maintain. So we started a project to replace it with a complete rewrite, is based on DBX class for the database backend and using Dancer to do the web framework stuff. But it's kind of a long running project. So we decided to do something else which is useful for much more people than just for e-commerce users, and also which was faster to implement. The topic is data database administration, which is used by many people if they want to manipulate the database without using SQL in the web interface. The things you are usually using there might be like phpMyAdmin and phpGAdmin. So you would need different ones for each database system. We started to do an application based on Dancer and DBX class, which is called the table editor, and the features of it it's based on DBX class, yes. So you can just access different database systems with the same interface, and you don't notice it at all. It has a higher level of abstraction than PHP MyAdmin, because it works on the objects and the classes instead of the SQL tables and columns. Which gives you a nice way to have relationships between the tables where you have foreign keys. You can just go by the show in a minute. It has a modern front end which is based on Angular and Bootstrap. So that means the actual source code we wrote for that in Chrome is really, really small. The front end is based on this Angular stuff, so this has also a routing system, so it's basically one page, and then you click stuff and does API calls to REST in the backend. And it has some installation. You need 4 commands to install it. It's not simple, it's for everyone because it requires quite a bit knowledge. So if you go there and you don't have configured anything, you can use any database you have. So you can put in the database driver, it's a drop down, so you can select Postgres, MySQL. It shows the things you have installed in the system, the DBI, and then you put in a database name and your credentials to access it. And if you have it, you can put in your DBX class Shiba, and then you can submit it and it will connect to the database. And if you don't specify a schema, it will generate one. So that looks like that. This is fun for database form for e-commerce application. On the left hand side you have a listing of the classes which relate to the database tables. And then you have a list of products. So you can go there and sort them by name or by priority or whatever. And here you got the 2 controls for updating an item and deleting an item. You can create a new one and also paging. And if you do the down, you model the product itself. So there's a product identifier, there's a name and all the fields you have. And yeah, and also you have the relationships. So products are easy to see. Or the product has attributes. Can be ordered. So if you click on one of these, you go to the related order line, and that means these products are in one order of the customer. So you can really navigate through it and it's easy to use. So, what do you need to make this happen? How do you use data, Adenza and DBX class together? The most important part of the picture is the plugin. The plugin is for Adenza plugin DBIC. And we show how to use it, how to configure it. We have a note over UTF-8. And also tell you how it creates a schema dynamically. So if you have normal code for DBX class, you have a schema which describes how your database structure is and how the tables and other stuff is related. And you can have additional logic inside that. So say, okay, I'm using my schema and then I connect. So let's do the database connection based on some parameters I get there. And then I already can make queries. So I go into the class user, which relates to the user table, and just can do a search. And then I get a list of objects back from the DBX class. If I'm using this with Adenza together and this plugin, it looks almost like the same. On top of it, I write Adenza plugin and DBX use it, and the only difference is that. That this is a keyword, so it doesn't have a sigil in front, and this keyword is brought you by the plugin. It's important your namespace and module, but the other things are the same. The difference is that you don't have to connect to the database because this is in the computation. And then you have two shortcuts to directly go into the class, the device and asset. So the configuration is more or less simple. You specify the schemas. So the one is chosen automatically is the default schema. So you say your database name and driver, your details for connecting to it. And last but not least, the schema class, the shape, which is schema. That's all that you need, and then you can use the keywords to do searches, updates, and whatever you need to do with the VX class. You can also do multiple schemas if you want to connect to different databases for different proposals. So you still have your before one, but you might have base, but you still need to get data from there. And you can say, okay, my legacy one, same pair of parameters, and I want to use it, my events application, and just put the schema identifier as argument for the schema keyword. Okay. But one thing which is kind of a thing you need to know, because it can really surprise you and make your web application buggy, it doesn't do by default UTF-8, which is nowadays the default for the web and also used in many databases as default encoding. So if you forget about it, you don't get your UTF-8 right out of the database, you have to set this option. It's passed through your database driver. Otherwise, UTF-8 encoding wouldn't work. And it's kind of sad because there's another plugin for Tensor, which is called Tensor Plugin Database, which also accesses databases but just gives you a DBI page handle, so you can just run your queries on it. And this automatically sets these flags. Because it looks into Tensor config, and Tensor config said, I'm using UTF-8, which is the default Tensor, and then I just set this flag. Okay, that's the thing you need to know if you use Tensor and DBSC together. So, if you want to create this schema dynamically from the database, you just drop out the schema class from the configuration, and you have to have DBX class schema loader installed, which is doing this creation. You don't have to produce the schema beforehand. This is quite nifty, for example, for the table you told you. You don't have, of course, a schema for every database you want to use, and also if you test something or you want to develop something. But if you really want to use a serious application, it's much better to first do your schema and from this schema produce the database. So, next thing which I wrote is an engine for Tensor, the session engine, which means you can store all the session details from the user, also a database through this DBAX class schema you have for your application. So usually you store the session like in a file, like serial or storable or whatever. And the other possibilities in Tensor to store your session data. But if your whole application is built on top of DBX class, it might make sense to also store the session inside it. So, I will tell you about the engines in Tensor in general, how to configure this session backend. There's also a thing about serialization, how your data is actually stored in the database. If you use this database-backed sessions, it's very important to use session exploration, unless you, otherwise your database table goes and goes and causes the problem. So I already mentioned that we have for different components engines in Tensor. That's for the templates, for the session and logger and serializer. And the good thing is, you have to just install the supporting module, which contains the engine, and put that in the configuration, and you're ready to go. So the Tensor configuration, you have a session, that we can put the name of the session engine. You have session options, where you can pass some parameters to the session engine. And we have a general thing called session expired, which means how long is the session for the users valid. After this time, the session is discarded, but it doesn't mean the session is deleted on the file system or the database or wherever it's stored. That's why we have to care on your own for the expiration. So in order to use it, I have prepared an example for that. So first, say, okay, I want to use TBIC, and then you have the database parameter, which is schema, and you can also configure in which table, which class is stored. So this is the size of the class, and then the columns for the session ID and for the session data. And this is an example, you say it's the session for the user expires after 12 hours. After what's any more valid. You also can do this basically when your application starts. So you say you have the set keyword to change stuff in the configuration of the answer. You can say TBIC. You can pass just your schema as you get it from the plugin. The plugin has a schema keyword that gives you an object to DBX class, schema, and then you just put in session options and you don't have to put the stuff into the configuration again because you already had configured the DBX plugin. Yeah. Example table is pretty simple, it will not look like that. Sessions ID, the session data. This is what you actually need. And also comes handy to store last modified so you for the session expiration. So by default, this DBC session uses JSON serializer. And you can use other serializers. If you configure them in the session office. So the session expiration, you need just to remove all sessions from the database. And for our e-commerce application, we have this class for the session. And we wrote an extra function to it. For this, so we can just say in our script, we expire all our records which are more than 12 hours. And this function inside the DBX class schema takes care of it. So, on top of the objects you have in your DBX class schema, you can add functions which you can use in your application. And that's good because you can put all the business logic inside it. So, the next part of my presentation, I will talk a little bit about a table tour, how it's installed, what is wanted, and other stuff. So, the installation is basically four steps. You get it from GitHub, go to the directory, you install the existing models. And then you execute this script, which basically starts the application. So you don't need any configuration for the database you want to use it with. And driver, you have to install the drivers as well, but otherwise they won't show up inside the dropdown when you connect to the database. So, the front end for the table tour is an Angular, which is a really nice tool to work with APIs. It also has routes for its front end, so it can delegate things to, for example, adding a data set, for adding data sets, for displaying stuff. And say all of the requests going through AJAX to the REST API, so there's no need for page load and stuff, which makes things slow and stuff like that. And all the communication is done in JSON. So the layout for the table tour is in Bootstrap, which means you can easily replace it with some other layout. There are a lot of teams you can get for Bootstrap, and you just exchange one file and you get your layout what you need. Of course, sometimes you have to adjust some things because the colors are visible or whatever. But it's pretty cool to get some other stuff for the design really quickly. So the routes inside of the denser part of the table, if you are looking at that. This is the HT method, get needs a normal request for the post request that forms it. And then we have this matching thing. So basically this is preceded with the column, the class, and the ID are parents. So they say slash user slash food is the URL. That means this is my class in the sheet schema, and this is the key of the record. So it would inside here and the end of the returns just the JSON file of the data which is inside the database record. And you also add the relationships so they can display it on the page, as you see in the beginning. One thing we are using too is the require login. So of course you want to have your table tour, your database administration protected. And this is by another plugin which has this keyboard require login. So if the user is not logged in, he never enters this route, so he can't see the data. This plugin is called Denser Plugin Out Extensible, and it's basically the main thing you want to use if you are using some authorization scheme inside your Denser application. So I would say it's a standard tool. Why it's a standard tool? It's quite flexible, so you can have different providers, that means different sources for your authentication. One of them is simple Unix. So you log in against your user account. You have a provider for a database, for DBSC, for LDAP, and you can write one on your own. The one thing I want to do for the table tour is log in based on the database credentials, like PHP MyAdministrator. So you don't have to have a different source for the authentication, just uses the thing as you want to connect to normal MySQL client to your database. But this is kind of difficult because this auth-extensible plugin just has only two parameters to pass on, username and the password, and you can't pass on like the database name and stuff like that. So we have to work out a solution for that. We support the following relationships. Might have as many, belongs to many to many. So, for example, what we had in the beginning, one product has many, can have many entries in the order table. Belongs to is a one to one relationship, and many to many is the relationship between, it's basically a bridge. We have three tables, one with users, and then the roles. And then we have connecting table for the user roles, and use this relationship to connect the user directly to the roles. So the current limitations of the table tour are basically we just use tables with the primary key, which is only for one column. I will find a solution for that. I think the problem is that Angular doesn't support that really. That might be problematic. The speed is not very good if you have really complex schemas, but I'm sure it can be optimized. And the error ending is not as good as it should, which is almost always the case with AX applications. So you get just one error, please reload the page or something. That's not good enough, in my opinion. Okay. Why the side of that? It's really interesting. Yeah, it's configuration. If you want to, you can add your favorite database configuration so you don't have to type in the beginning. And you can configure the order extensible. That's the only things you can configure. You need to configure. Plan features are better search based on Solr, Elasticsearch, or some of these frameworks. Method to select between different schemas. For example, if you define many of them in the configuration, or you can store different ones in your database. And one other thing is I want to produce a Debian package for this. As I'm a Debian maintainer, and you know, many of us can install stuff like that from GitHub and C1M, but for the normal user, that's too difficult. Okay. So that was what Ableton. And the next thing I want to tell you is not directly related to Danza, but something I found which is yeah, it's not really documented, and it's useful if you're using DBX class, especially together with web applications. So say you have a simple table with rows, three columns, so you can say a database select from rows where rows are either equals three, simple. And if you want to use the same for DBX class, say it's a class role, I want to find the entry with the primary key fee, and then I can access the primary key, name, label, whatever. That's really simple. It's not so simple. It's not so simple if you want to debug stuff you get from the DBX class. Because if you get this this role object from the DBX class, and say that's a debug role, the output is so big. It's really, really big. So it fills really a lot and you can't really see what's about it. So for debugging, logging, it would be really good to get the hashref. You can say debug your hashref and you see just the columns which are inside this object. Other usages for that are templates, because most templates don't support if you're pushing object to them. They won't have to make a hashref, an array, something like that. And also for the table example, they have an API which was in JSON. There's also no need for objects. And if you know beforehand that you don't need objects, it's even faster if you tell the DBX class I want a hashref. So, there's the function you can need on your DBX class object. It's called getInfectColumns and just gives you a hash. That's a really good tool to use. Yeah. So yeah. Almost done. Just a few things about the future and development. Get the stuff to table editor. And also, what about Danza 2? Danza 2 is a reincarnation and basically a write of Danza 1, which should be coming to production ready like this year. But it was completely revised, so we cannot use plugins and engines for this, for Danza 1. So there's already a DBX C plugin for Danza 2. And yesterday, ported my session DBX C engine to Danza 2 as well. And yeah, variable WME remains to be important. Okay, finally, here you can get my slides. They're also on the ACT website. Now it's time for questions.
They're using this way to JCX. You can tell them this way to JCX, right? For all the projects as well.
Yeah, we're using container 6 and using the table tour as a base for a simple administration for the job. Anything else? Okay, if you have more questions, I'm on, so thank you.